Amen. Today we have our very own Reverend Julie Grace with us, and she's going to bring the word of God.
Amen.
The missionaries requested that she preach on this missionary day, and I want you all to pray with her and pray for her.
Amen.
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 The message this morning comes from Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 3, and Romans chapter 15, verse 14. Acts 13, 1 through 3 reads, "Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simon, Lucius, Manaen, and Saul. While they were worshiping," the Bible says, "the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.'"
Uh-huh.
"So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and set them off." In Romans 15, 14, it reads, "And myself also am persuaded of you, my brethren, that ye also are full of goodness, filled with all knowledge, and also able to admonish one another."
Uh-huh.
"Today is missionary day, and as appropriate, there is a word from the Lord for our missionaries and for the church."
Yeah.
"The tag of this message is 'Go and do likewise.'"
Uh-huh.
"Go and do likewise."
Yeah.
"Mission within this context is a task on which God sends a person he called, particularly to introduce a group of people to salvation in Christ. In the Christian context, the person sent is called a missionary.
Uh-huh.
This person is charged with the task of spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ to the people. The mission of the church is to send our missionaries to all parts of the world until everyone has had an opportunity to hear the message of Jesus and accept him as Lord.
Tell it.
Interestingly, the term missionary is not found in Scripture. Yet the concept of mission permeates the entire Bible.
Tell it.
God's work in the Old Testament is both revelatory and redemptive regarding mission.
Uh-huh.
It is revelatory because people who know who God is because of what he's done.
Oh, yes.
It is redemptive because God sent his messengers to the house of Israel and his prophets and as his spokesman to all nations.
Tell it.
In the New Testament, the mission begins with Jesus who was sent to earth to reveal the Father.
That's right.
To glorify him.
To
bring the kingdom of God on earth. And to make God's love and mercy known to a lost world. He came to seek the lost.
Yes.
Through his teaching.
Tell it.
Jesus made it clear that his mission was to continue after he ascended. Each of the Gospels and Acts contain an account of his mandate to his followers, telling them to go to all the world. Don't wait for the world to come to you.
Tell it.
Reach out beyond yourself.
Uh-huh.
Cross barriers. Reach out to all ethnic groups, clans, tribes, social classes, and cultures.
Uh-huh.
"And I have come to tell First Baptist to just get out of your seats and hit the streets. And make the country baptize them and share the gospel."
Uh-huh. Tell it.
This mandate was taken seriously by the prophets and teachers, and the greatest of the missionaries is Paul.
Tell it.
In Acts 13, we find the beginning of the second part of Acts with Antioch at the center of operations, no longer Jerusalem. Paul is now the central figure instead of Jerusalem hesitated too long to carry out the command of Jesus to take the gospel to the world.
Yes, sir.
That glory now belongs to Antioch.
Yes, sir. Tell it.
Be careful taking your time. Okay. Be careful taking your time.
Okay.
When God has assigned you to do something.
Yeah. Tell it, tell it.
So Luke tells us about the leadership resources of Antioch congregation.
Yeah.
Five men are named and two spiritual gifts come into focus.
Yeah.
He named Barnabas,
uh-huh,
who was serving as senior pastor in the Antioch congregation. Not to be confused with Barnabas in Paul's letter in the Galatians. Then there is Simon,
uh-huh,
a leader in the church of Antioch.
Yeah.
The remaining three men named in this scripture are Lucius and Cyrene,
uh-huh,
Nahum,
mm-hmm,
and Saul.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we know Saul as a regenerated persecutor.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Now the chief teacher of the Antioch church.
Yeah.
It is noteworthy that there was a large number of godly and gifted teachers in the church of Antioch.
Uh-huh. Tell it.
There were probably other gifted and godly leaders who,
yes,
had initially come to Antioch,
wow,
with the good news for the gospel.
Uh-huh.
So being a part of a church with a large number of godly and gifted leaders was,
yeah,
ideal for the Roman Christians and prayerfully,
wow,
is ideal for the church today.
Amen. Tell it, tell it.
Leadership by a large number of gifted and godly people paves the way for real church growth.
Go ahead, tell it.
The kind of growth that results from sending out missionaries and even planting new churches.
Yeah.
Plurality of leadership and gifts is one of the things that we should always appreciate about the church.
Uh-huh.
The ideal church recognizes God as the head.
Uh-huh.
One shepherd that comes under God,
tell it,
and over the ability or the stability of a number of very gifted and godly people.
Yes, sir.
Especially missionaries.
Uh-huh. Preach it, preach it, preach it.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be grand if we recognize the privilege of being sent out?
Uh-huh.
Yes.
Preach it, preach it.
Wouldn't it be grand?
Go ahead.
If we were privileged to send out a number of gifted and godly missionaries to,
yeah,
to various parts of the world,
yeah,
I submit it would be grand,
amen,
if we would send them to every community in Williamsburg,
yeah,
and the surrounding area.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
The climate in the congregation of the Roman Christian Church was that of worship and fasting.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
The King James Version of Acts 13 reads, as they ministered to the Lord. Let's stop right here.
Go ahead, tell it.
As they ministered to the Lord.
Yeah.
They ministered to the Lord as the priests who served in the tabernacle in Exodus 28.
Uh-huh.
When they ministered, that was their worship.
Yeah.
Amen.
The NIV reads, while they were worshiping the Lord. In other words, as they served the Lord,
uh-huh,
they worshiped.
Tell it.
Meaning, as they aided others in poverty, as is written in Rome,
uh-huh,
when they served and ministered unto the Lord, they were really serving and ministering to the people.
Yeah.
Their service and their ministering to the people was their worship unto the Lord.
Go ahead, tell it.
I need us to understand this morning that when we serve each other,
uh-huh,
we serve the Lord.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
When we minister to each other,
yeah,
we minister to the Lord.
Go ahead, tell it.
This is our worship,
uh-huh,
unto the Lord.
Yeah. Preach it.
But the other side of that is when we mistreat each other.
Come on now.
We mistreat the Lord.
Yeah. Go ahead.
When we disrespect each other,
come on.
We respect the Lord. We,
yeah,
need to understand that.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Whatever we do to our neighbor, we do it unto the Lord.
Yeah.
The Bible says that The people were serving unto the Lord. Not frantic activities with programs burning out everybody.
Go ahead.
Come on, sir.
Go ahead.
Paul is teaching us today.
Teach or preach it. Yes.
The Roman church had numerous godly and gifted leaders.
Yeah.
And the climate in the church
come on.
Was that of worshiping unto the Lord.
Yeah.
I've come to tell First Baptist this morning.
Tell us, tell us.
We must go and do likewise.
Yeah. Go ahead. Tell it, tell it.
The Bible goes on to tell us that the Roman church presented an attitude of worship and fasting.
Yeah.
They devoted themselves to serving the Lord as they fasted.
Go ahead.
Fasting here is related to service. Rather than to prayer.
Go ahead.
But prayer was no doubt a part of their service because we recall that the apostles purposed to devote themselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. But my point here for pressing this understanding of fasting is that these men, Barnabas and Paul, did not fast and then serve. Come on, somebody. God spoke. He spoke to these men while they were already serving. They were already consumed with their ministry and their fasting. They absorbed all of their attention and energy in their ministry as they fasted. They were not consumed in two or three or four ministries. They were consumed in their ministry. The ministry of mission. They were serving in the ministry of mission as they fasted. But many more seem to be waiting when they should be working. all absorbed and put all of his attention and all of his energy into his mission.
Yes.
And as I said earlier, Paul is the most outstanding of all missionaries mentioned today. And so I want to take a few minutes and take a closer look at Paul.
Come on, tell her.
Because I believe that we can learn a lot from him. Paul had a strong desire and determination to spread the gospel. In his message, he preached and he taught regarding self-denial on behalf of others. Y'all get quiet on me. He said to please others.
Preach it.
And not yourself. Bear the weakness of the weak.
Yes.
Please neighbors for their good.
Yes.
Let me say that again. Please neighbors for their good.
Yes. Preach it.
And their edification.
Oh, yes.
Come on, First Baptist. Can we do that?
Yes.
Can we please others first?
Yes.
Paul always provided Jesus as the perfect example who did not please himself and accepted them as they were.
Yeah.
Jesus did not please himself in the Garden of Gethsemane when he prayed to his Father, not my will, but thy will. Jesus did not please himself when he died on the cross for you and me.
Come on, tell it.
He did not please himself when he said on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Preach it.
This kind of denial called talk could only be accomplished by being on one accord.
Preach it.
With one voice. Glorifying God who gives us perseverance and encourage to be of the same mind with one another. Now he also recognized that what he asked them to do was not easy. Especially not in the power of human ability. Joy and peace, he taught, are supernatural manifestations of the Holy Spirit. And any hope of learning to love the Gentiles and those with different racial and ethnic backgrounds more than themselves can only come through the Holy Spirit.
Preach it.
Cannot do it on your own.
Preach it.
Paul used Jesus as model, as the model for the church to follow. Missionaries and leaders and ministries of First Baptist. Go and do likewise.
Preach it.
This message that Paul preached to the people that of that time, which applies to the missionaries today, is hard for most people to grasp.
Go ahead. Tell it.
Second thought, maybe not. Maybe it's just that we don't want to grasp.
That's it.
Because, listen, if I put myself before you, I might miss out on something for myself. If you need money to put soup on your table to feed your family, and I give you some of my money, I may have to have soup for dinner instead of my steak and potatoes and asparagus and peach cobbler, and don't forget the wine that I'm accustomed to having. Now, after I've had my steak and my potatoes and all the trimmings, then I might give you some money to put soup on your table for your family. Jesus and Paul taught the people.
Deny
yourself on behalf of others. Love your neighbor as yourself. Missionaries and leaders and ministers of First Baptist go and do likewise. Paul had a servant's heart. A description of servant's heart is found in Philippians 2 and 3.
Tell it.
He says, do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others more significant
Jesus.
Than yourself.
Yeah.
Paul was adamant about this self-denial.
Uh-huh. Okay.
He said, let each of you look not only to your own interests,
yes.
but to the interests of others. Yes.
Tell it.
Have this in mind among yourself, he said,
mm-hmm.
which is yours in Christ Jesus.
Uh-huh.
I'm talking yes. about a servant's heart.
Yeah, right. tell it.
1 Corinthians 15 reads, therefore, my beloved brothers and sisters, be steadfast,
uh-huh.
immovable,
Boy.
Always abounding in the work of
yes.
the Lord,
yeah.
knowing that in the Lord,
hallelujah,
yeah. your labor is not in vain.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm talking about a servant's heart.
Uh-huh. Preach it.
Ephesians 6 yeah. says, rendering service with a good will
yeah.
as to the Lord and not to man or woman.
Uh-huh.
I'm talking about a servant.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Wow.
Come on.
Paul practiced the wisdom of Solomon.
Go ahead.
He made plans counting on God's direction.
Mm-hmm.
He engaged other Christians to assist him in carrying out his long-term yes. goals and his plans.
Yes.
However, his goals and desires were not self-serving.
Well,
amen.
He involved the Roman Christians in the priority of the church
yeah.
to reach all nations with the gospel.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Missionaries, go and do likewise.
Yeah. Ooh, yeah. I hate it.
Paul was ambitious about spreading the gospel.
Uh-huh.
How many of us have a strong desire and passion to spread the gospel?
Go ahead.
Missionaries of this great church, how many of us involve members of this congregation
preach it.
In the priority of the church
yes.
to reach all nations
yes.
or all communities with the gospel?
Uh-huh. I get it.
What if we celebrated Missionary Day and Christian Education Day and Men's Day and Women's Day and all other ministry days, and instead of preaching and eating inside this
church? Why don't you tell me now?
We corporately get out of our seats
to
reach the surrounding community with the word of God.
Okay.
We don't have to wait on the pastor and the preacher to spread the gospel.
Okay, tell it again.
We've been called.
Yeah.
Get up.
Yeah. Okay.
As James Brown would say, get on up.
Yeah. Do it!
The Roman Christians were complete Knowledge gained by learning, by effort,
go ahead,
or experience.
Yes.
Doctrinally,
uh-huh,
these believers were taught with no great deficiencies in their biblical and theological knowledge.
Uh-huh.
They also applied what they learned.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
This was the condition of the Roman Christian church.
Uh-huh.
Is this the condition of perspective?
Well, help us, help us.
Paul taught these Christians.
Yeah.
That's why they were full of goodness and complete in knowledge.
Uh-huh.
They were taught.
They were taught.
They were taught.
Okay. Okay.
Do we avail ourselves to be taught?
No.
Come on, somebody.
Come on, come on.
to lovingly confront those veering off the path.
Yes.
This is a critical need for every church.
Come on, tell it.
Many of us fail to handle conflict the way we should.
Yeah.
We either go into denial and avoid the confrontation altogether.
Yes.
Or we face it head on with a prideful attitude.
Yeah.
Or we acknowledge the problem but shrug it off for the sake of maintaining a friendship.
Mm.
All three of these reactions are inappropriate and stunts church growth.
Yes, sir. Hey, preach it.
God expects us to lovingly admonish those believers.
Yeah.
I said lovingly.
Lovingly.
Who he has placed in your life. That means your friends.
Come on now.
And your family. You
that
he's placed in your life.
Yes.
We have a responsibility to admonish them.
Yeah.
In love.
In love.
I hear you.
This is not a duty for the pastor. It is a duty for us.
Amen. I want to preach that thing. Preach for me. Yeah.
Often we have a greater impact.
A greater impact. Teach it.
Than the body that the pastor.
Go ahead.
Amen.
Amen.
Grace to be ministers of Jesus to the people.
Yes.
Not ministering as a priest in the temple as in the Old Testament. We are ministers of Jesus serving on the front line of our community.
Teach it.
So instead of having a priestly duty to bring animal sacrifices as an offering, like Paul, our priestly duty is to share the good news about Jesus with everyone.
Yes.
Okay.
God gave Paul grace to minister, and he will give us grace.
Okay.
God called missionaries, supported by a strong home congregation, can take the gospel anywhere, and we will see unbelievers turn to God. God leads the church to call out missionaries for the work that God is developing in this world.
Preach it.
So listen, missionaries and leaders. Ministry is a gracious privilege.
Yes.
It's a gracious privilege.
Yes.
I need you to get that.
Yes.
And I know it's hard sometimes.
Preach it.
And it's easy to feel that you're being taken for granted.
Come on.
Unappreciated.
Yeah.
And so sometimes we try false self-encouragement and we try to convince ourselves that the church is lucky to have us.
Well, okay. Preach it.
But I've come to tell you.
Tell it.
It is a blessing.
Yeah.
To serve this church.
Yeah. Preach it.
Ministry to others is a privilege.
Yeah.
Not a burden.
Well.
Yeah.
I get it. All
right.
Okay.
When you have served in ministry for an extended period of time, it's easy to grow weary and disillusioned.
Yes.
But I ask you to commit to pray for a greater awareness of the privilege of ministry. To the missionaries.
Tell it.
The gospel is a precious responsibility.
Yes.
A priest handled an offering very carefully in order to keep it holy. You must handle the gospel just as carefully. You must see yourselves as spiritual heart surgeons. Deal with matters of eternal life and death.
Yeah. Preach it.
How well do you know the gospel of Jesus Christ? Have you mastered its content?
Come on, tell it.
God has called you. Hallelujah.
I'm going to ask one of these deacons to pray. Deacon Benjamin Hovey, I'm going to ask you to do the altar call this morning. Amen. Let us bow our heads in prayer.
Lord, we thank
you. Yes. Talk with it. Talk with it.
Right now.
Right now.
Lord, as I look back over my life.
Yes.
And have seen how good you have been to
oh,
me.
Yes.
Lord, I can go and do likewise.
Yes.
Tell somebody
yes.
about the goodness of the Lord. Lord, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
For First Baptist Church.
Oh, yes.
Thank you for Reverend Graves who bought such a beautiful word.
Oh, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For our pastor. Thank you.
Thank you.
For the missionary.
Yes.
Lord, that they'll hold a sign over their head, cross around their neck.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
But Lord, they go.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. For all those that are in this church.
Oh, yes. Talk with
you. That minister to somebody.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Maybe it's a kind word.
Well,
maybe it's a prayer.
Yes.
Maybe it's a few dollars.
Yes.
Maybe it's a song. Lord, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
That they have touched somebody.
Oh, yes.
Lord, these who have assembled around their altar. Lord, I don't know what their situation
well,
is. But Lord, I know you do.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Lord, you told Moses to tell the Pharaoh that I am sent you.
Yes, sir.
Lord, let the people around the altar know
yes, sir.
That he is, that he am. The God.
Oh, yes.
He can handle sickness.
Yes, sir.
Diabetes.
Oh, yes.
Cancer.
Talk with him.
Lord, he can handle all manner of illness.
Yes.
Lord, the cattle on a thousand hills.
Yes, sir.
Belong to our Lord and Savior.
Oh, yes.
Those who have financial problems.
Yes.
Help them that they call on you.
Yes.
Those whose relatives are sick.
Talk with him. Talk with
him. Those whose children are hard.
Yeah. Yeah.
Those who have had problems on their job.
Yes.
Lord, you are.
Yes, sir.
And you can help everybody.
Oh, yes.
Lord, touch them.
Touch them, Lord. Touch
right
them.
Now. Lord, let your Holy Spirit come like a dove.
Oh, yes.
Touch on their heart.
Yes, sir.
Let it be in their lips.
Yes.
Let it be in their mind.
Yes.
Let them know that there's nothing.
Nothing.
Too hard for God. Lord, bless us.
Please, Lord.
Keep us.
Yes.
Create within us clean
hearts. Oh, yes.
Renew within us the right spirit.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That people can look at us and know that we are yours.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Lord, help all of us
oh, yes.
to be missionaries.
Yes.
Lord, we pray
yes.
that somebody holding hands
yes.
will receive a missionary
oh, yes.
sometime yes. during their life.
Oh, yes.
While it's money, love, Lord, touch them.
Touch them. Touch them, Lord.
Let them know that thou art God.
Yeah.
And then, Lord, we can't do nothing to your Holy Spirit.
Lord, yes, sir.
Lord, come.
Come.
Holy Spirit.
Yes, sir.
Come, Holy
yes, sir.
Spirit.
Lord, yes.
Sprinkle a flame of fire
yes,
in these old cold hearts of ours.
Oh, yes.
Come, bring your people.
Bless. Talk with it. Talk with it.
Come, come and bring your word.
Talk with it. Talk with it. Talk with it.
We pray.
Yes, sir.
In the name of Jesus,
yes.
Yes. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Bless you.